Gowon regroups. Following the Biafran invasion of the Midwest, Gowon reorganized his war strategy. He placed some of his best military personnel in tricky roles as part of his agenda to crush the Biafrans. Mohammed Shua was commander-in-charge of the 1st Division of the Federal Army. His orders were to advance from northern Nigeria with his troops to take the Biafran towns of Nsukka and Oguja. Colonel Murtala Mohammed, in charge of Division 2, had marching orders to retake Benin and the other parts of the Midwest occupied by the Biafran army and then cross the river Niger into Onitsha. Finally, Division 3 of the Nigerian army, led by Benjamin Adekunle, aka the Black Scorpion, would commandeer a southern offensive. 3 months later, the Nigerian forces, now more organized and armed to the teeth with British weapons, had staged a successful counter-offensive. The Biafrans were now in full retreat. The Nigerian army pushed back the Biafrans and arrived at the outskirts of the Republic of Benin in September 1967, led by Murtala Mohammed. His 2nd Infantry Division mounted a resurgent attack from two fronts, defending their advance and pushing forward in a classic Greek army offensive. The retreating Biafran forces, according to several accounts, allegedly beat up a number of Midwesterners who they believed had served as saboteurs. Nigerian radio reports claim that the Biafrans shot a number of innocent civilians as they fled the advancing federal forces. As disturbing as these allegations are, I have found no credible corroboration of them. The Asaba Massacre. The federal forces were soon able to snatch Benin from Biafran military hands and advance quickly toward the River Niger, arriving in Asaba in early October 1967. There are multiple versions of what transpired in Asaba. The version I heard amounted to this. Murtala Mohammed, Chief Commander, GOC, Division 2, and his lieutenants, including Colonel Ibrahim Haruna, felt humiliated by the Biafran Midwestern offensive, armed with direct orders to retake the occupied areas at all costs. This division rounded up and shot as many defenseless Igbo men and boys as they could find. Some reports placed the death toll at 500, others as high as 1,000. The Asaba Massacre, as it would be known, was only one of many such post-program atrocities committed by Nigerian soldiers during the war. It became a particular abomination for Asaba residents, as many of those killed were titled Igbo chiefs and common folk alike, and their bodies were disposed of with reckless abandon in mass graves, without regard to the wishes of the families of the victims or the town's ancient traditions. His Holiness Pope Paul VI, having received no commitment from either the Nigerians or the Biafrans for a ceasefire, sent his emissary, the well-regarded Monsignor Georges Rocho, to Nigeria on a fact-finding mission. The horrified Roman Catholic priest spoke to the French newspaper Le Monde following the visit, recounting what he witnessed. There has been genocide, for example, on the occasion of the 1966 massacres. Two areas have suffered badly from the fighting. Firstly, the region between the towns of Benin and Asaba, where only widows and orphans remain. Federal troops, having for unknown reasons massacred all men. General Gowon broke his silence 35 years later on this matter and apologized for these atrocities to the Igbos in Asaba. It came to me as a shock when I came to know about the unfortunate happenings that happened to the sons and daughters of Asaba domain. I felt very touched, and honestly I referred to the killings and acts of forgiveness being the one who was in charge at that time. Certainly, it is not something that I would have approved of in whatsoever. I was made ignorant of it, I think, until it appeared in the papers. A young man wrote a book at that time. Testifying at the Justice Oputa panel, a Nigerian version of South Africa's Truth and Reconciliation Commission, Major General Ibrahim Rahuna, belligerent and unremorseful as ever, proclaimed, "As the commanding officer and leader of the troops that massacred 500 men in Asaba, I have no apology for those massacred in Asaba, or worry, and Emeka Item. I acted as a soldier maintaining the peace and unity of Nigeria. If General Yakubu Gowon apologized, he did it in his own capacity. As for me, I have no apology." Murtala Mohammed advanced quickly, following the abomination in Asaba, to cross the Niger River Bridge to Onitsha. Mohammed's federal troops sustained many casualties in that guerrilla warfare and from sniper attacks by Achuzie's Biafran troops, and they failed to take the market town in the first attempt. Biafran repercussions, they exhausted. Fleeing Biafran soldiers crossed the River Niger and arrived in Enugu, Biafra's capital. Their actions had unanticipated consequences. Ojukwu nursing the wounds of, as he saw it, a self-inflicted defeat, summarily court-martialed the leaders of the exercise. The accused men, Brigadier Victor Banjo, Major Emmanuel Ifajuna, Sam Abamuche, and Major Philip Alele, were found guilty of planning a coup d'etat to overthrow Ojukwu's regime, a treasonable felony punishable by death. All four men were executed on September 25, 1967. It is important to point out that at the time, Enugu had a conspiratorial atmosphere and some in Ojukwu's inner circle added fuel to the fire. There was talk of alleged plots to overthrow the government. Rumors swirled that Major Ifajuna, a mastermind of the January 15, 1966 coup, was spotted by Biafran intelligence in covert meeting with British Secret Service agents. Others alleged that the British had paid Victor Banjo a large commission to the tune of several thousand pounds to bungle the Midwestern advance. Such was the climate of fear and paranoia. Blood, blood everywhere. The Biafrans found themselves under heavy assault after the Midwest offensive. Mohammed Shriwa's 1st Army Division, advancing with Theophilus Danjuma, quickly overran the university town of Onsuka and then relentlessly bombarded Biafra's capital with heavy armaments. The military operation was aided by Egyptian mercenary pilots flying the Nigerian Army's brand new British Chirk L-29 Dolphins and Soviet MiG-17 and Ilyushin Beagle 228 aircraft. Most of us in the civilian population had fled with family members into the hinterland ahead of the advancing Nigerian troops. By the second week of October 1967, overwhelmed by the Nigerian military pounding, the Biafran central government also receded southward to Umuahia, where a new capital was set up. By now, the world had started taking notice, and a number of international organizations were visiting Nigeria to try to broker a peace between the two warring parties. One of the first to intervene was the Organization of African Unity, OAU, which appointed Ghanaian Lieutenant General Joseph Arthur Ankrah, their emissary to Biafra. Ankrah had some experience with the conflict, having hosted the Aburi meeting in January. Many Biafrans, myself included, had mixed feelings about the OAU's choice, as Ankrah, widely regarded as a Cold War pawn, was the man responsible for deposing one of the heroes of the African liberation struggle, Kwame Nkrumah. It was little surprise to those of us in Biafra, therefore, to discover that under his guidance, the OAU supported a unified Nigeria, stance, despite Biafra's protests.